want us to understand one of the things about honoring those who sacrifice all. We don't really honor their death, right? We'll look at that. We honor their life. Living with a transforming purpose. It's terrible when you steal someone else's outline. No, honest, I wrote it myself. Transforming purpose. Something that, you know, your life, when you get to the end, what is going to be said, right? What's going to be your obituary's focus? Think about that with me for a minute. It was disturbing for me because I woke up with several dreams. It was up most of the night because I kept having dreams because this thought was in my head. What will people say? Right? He was or she was loving. Right? A loving husband, maybe. Joyce might lie and put that on. Well, what did you enjoy? He enjoyed, right? Really liked cars. Really liked tractors. Really enjoyed fishing. What would be brought out? He was associated with, right? The clubs and sometimes the church is added in there. Faithful member, faithful attender, part of. Let me ask this. Who do you want to impress with the reading of your life? I mean, if someone was to, you know, if you sat down right now and wrote out your own eulogy, who do you want to go, huh? I mean, because you want, it's going to be evaluated by your peers, right? Those around you are going to look and read. I mean, we're inundated here in New Haven here lately. There's like four or five people who passed away, and I always stop to read their obituary. I read what the funeral home put out. I try to see where they were connected to see if I might have had any connection with them, because sometimes I forget. We went and ate at a restaurant for breakfast yesterday. People were saying hi, and Joyce kept going, "Who are they?" I'm like, "People we know." And it took a while, right? And so sometimes I read through to try to figure out where is that connection. But let me ask you, how are you going to be evaluated by my Savior or your Savior? When you get to heaven, how would God write your eulogy, right? What will the Lord say about your life? See, because when we celebrate Memorial Day and we look at a soldier who has fallen, it's not about how they died, but really how they lived, right? It's not that they went out and died. It's that they, along with, there's over 2 million soldiers right now serving in our military that may end up giving their all for the country. But see, what we celebrate is how they suited up and were willing to serve, right? None of them today are getting up going, "I'm dying today." But because the way they lived, and if they called to go into a situation and they give their lives, our country wants to honor them. Now, if you get a chance at all, you should go to Arlington Cemetery. And you should watch some of the ceremonies that go on there. Because it is cool how we strive to honor our fallen soldiers. Paul had this thing. And we're going to be in the book of Philippians this morning. Because I want you to see how Paul lived in understanding how he lived is going to affect how he dies. How he lives is going to affect how he dies. Philippians 1:21 says this, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Paul is writing to the church at Philippi from prison. Locked up for the gospel. Because he enjoyed sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, he's in prison. He's writing to the church at Philippi, and from what I read, the church at Philippi, or the country of Philippi, is a Roman stronghold. It was like a little Roman copy. You know, everyone there was wanting to follow everything that came out of Rome. So he's writing in a hard situation to a church in a hard situation. And he gives us so much in the book of Philippians that could help us live in a way that when we die, don't you hate it when a sentence halfway, you're like, how do I correct that? It's too late. And so it's how we're living for the Lord, or how we're living, is going to determine how our eulogy is written. See, answer this question, or fill in these blanks. Living. Paul said living is Christ, and really, the word isn't in there, it's just living Christ. It was the consuming theme for Paul. To live, everything was Christ, not Sunday morning, but every breathing, waking moment of his life was living for Christ. And how would you feel in the dying part? Our culture has not in a Christian culture is no longer embracing death. I mean, I don't want to hasten it, but at the same time, do you understand absent from the body, present with the Lord? This is not heaven. This is not the kingdom we're ushering in. This is where we're passing through. So listen, if you're living for money, right? When you don't have money, you pretty much feel dead, right? If this is what you're living for, the absence of it determines that I don't have what I need. Maybe it's fame. All of a sudden you don't have fame. It's like, it's not it. You're down, depressed. Maybe it's your health. I'm not saying health isn't a good thing, but if that's what consumes you, then when you don't have health, there's a problem. You're down. But see, Paul said, no, why I live and how I live is consumed by Christ. Over health, money, fame, you put in there, whatever it is, that my life is lost in Jesus Christ. And when I die, the good thing is, he gains more of Christ. He gets to be with whom he's living for. That's his goal. That's his understanding. That's what's consuming everything that's going on. And listen, church, if we as Christians will get a hold of this, the pitfalls of this world won't be as deep. Because we're consumed with what truly matters. The word there, gain, means to cash in both principal and interest. See, the only thing we can send up for all eternity is a life given to Christ. You could have a lot of property. Someone's auctioning it off or selling it. You can have a lot of possessions. Someone is selling it or junking it. You can't send any of those things up. Now, they are blessings for us to enjoy in Christ. And I'm not saying don't have anything, but I want you to understand, being consumed with the things of Christ will change your whole philosophy of how you live here. How you follow. And so what was his theme throughout the book of Philippians? If his goal is to live for Christ and to die is gain, what's his goal? I want you to see several verses as we make sense of this. His theme is the gospel. Now the gospel, now listen, the gospel and its message is understanding, first of all, we're sinners and we fall short of the glory of God. Listen, you're not good enough to go to heaven. Your destiny outside of Jesus in John 3:18 is that you're condemned. And you won't make heaven. And the gospel then says Jesus, the Messiah, who was all God, all man, came into the world, died on the cross for our sins. That if you'll repent, key element by the way, and receive what Jesus Christ did on the cross, you can be saved. That's the gospel. And Paul, through the book of Philippians, and if you'll follow it through, in verse 5, he says it's the fellowship in the gospel, or the partnership in the gospel. There's one thing we should be excited about, is that we have a partnership, and our partnership is not built on our economic status, right? It's not based on our property ownership. It's not based on whether we're from this part of the world or that part of the world. It is based, he says, we have this fellowship that is brought about by the gospel. That you were once lost, but now you are saved. Then he goes on, he says the defense and confirmation of the gospel. He's willing to defend the gospel. We've lost that, and we're going to talk about it here in a second. But we need to stop just thinking everyone that says Jesus is a Christian. We gotta understand there's supposed to be a defense of the gospel. If we keep including people that they're Christian and they're not Christian, we're making people feel good till they die and spend eternity in hell. That's the saddest thing in the world for me. Well, don't you think all of them over there are saved? No, because I know all the Baptists aren't. Some of y'all just sit here, have no clue why. Hope maybe, I guess it gets you to heaven. But when you understand the gospel, I'm getting ahead, so maybe the last part will be shorter. The furtherance of the gospel. It says everything I'm going through is for the furtherance of the gospel. Mentions the defense of the gospel again in verse 17. Verse 27, he says the conversation that becomes the gospel, or our life's behavior should be about the gospel, striving together for the faith of the gospel. In other words, it takes work. Serve me in the gospel. 4:3, labor with me in the gospel. 4:15, the beginning of the gospel. So, if you look at the book of Philippians and you read through it several times, there's a theme of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul is consumed no matter what's going on in his life, with the gospel of Jesus Christ. This morning, are you saved? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior? Does it consume you? Or it's, glad I'm in. I don't really care about anyone else. I want to enjoy my life and not cause any waves. See here, this is his life. He was a citizen of the gospel. I want you to know, when people join the military, one thing they're told and is stressed to, that their life is no longer theirs. That the government owns them. Understand? There's no ifs, ands, buts about it. If they want to move you somewhere, you move there. Because they own you. They let you make suggestions of where you want to go. And I think that's just so they won't send you where you want to go. Hey, where would you like to be stationed? I'm like, I'm putting Outer Slobovia and all these. Maybe they'll send me somewhere nice. Whatever you do, don't send me anywhere nice. But they own you. See, Paul saying that I'm owned. I'm owned by this gospel that has transformed me, that has saved me. He said in verse 5, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. The word fellowship or koinonia is actually meaning a partnership. It's not a loose fellowship. It's a partnership, and it's used as if you went into business with someone. We're in this together. Listen, church, we got to return not to being about anything, but being about the gospel. People are lost and separated from God, and we'll spend an eternity separated from God unless we understand God called us together here at Memorial Baptist Church to be about the gospel. He goes on in verse 27, let your conversation, your attitude, your walk of life, your behavior be as it becomes the gospel of Christ. That whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs. And he says, I want you to do this. See, if you're in this partnership, you stand fast together. Our personality differences don't deter us from standing strong in the gospel. Right? Our musical instrument the desires don't deter us for how we stand in the gospel. We have a purpose. And the purpose is to share the gospel with one spirit. Love this. Because see, when I got saved, I got all of the Spirit of God. And when you got saved, you got all of the Spirit of God. And see, if we're all about the Spirit of God and the gospel of God, guess what? We should have some connectivity. Why? Because we're kin. We're kin. And I know we're not all the same, but then we still have one mind, and that mind is Jesus Christ. How does these things become the gospel? I sometimes grieve to get back to where I was when I first got saved. Because when I first got saved, I witnessed to everyone. I witnessed to all of my family because they were lost and going to hell. I took track to a public high school and carried my Bible to a public high school because I, more than anything, I wanted them to get saved. I just thought, I got salvation. You need it. And today we go, well, I think they're okay. I want to get back to where the gospel is such a driving force that we're not okay to think they're okay. We want to know. We just need to, you know, when there's tornadoes and all these things that we've been having, you know, one of the things they do, you know, is they do a well check, right? They just go, knock on the door. Hey, just want to make sure everybody's okay. You need to make a list of your friends and just say, hey, I just want to make a well checkup. And some of y'all are getting old. And I just want you to know, your friends, at least around my culture, they're getting older. I understand that. I seem to hold. People keep dying. One mind, hey, we consume striving, working together for the faith of the gospel. There's got to be an urgency. See, I don't mind walking with someone and help them through some love to find Jesus. My only problem is it's taking too long and they could die. See, I think to die well, you should live as a committed citizen of the gospel. This is what my life is about. We made pictures of Joyce's dad yesterday, and she's made some pillows of, anyway, some old shirts he had. I don't think he had any new ones. But anyway, we've made these heart-shaped pillows and sending them to the grandkids and whatever, and some of them. She put a picture of him, and it was a good picture of him, because in his top left pocket was God's simple plan and salvation tracts. Y'all remember those days? Everyone had a tract. He just gave them to people. Now somehow, giving someone a tract is offensive. I don't want to offend them. Oh, so you want them to go to hell? You know, when I drew this sermon out, it wasn't as hard, but some of y'all need this, I guess. I don't know where I need it. Or I should have got more sleep, whatever, however that plays out. Let's get this here. Defenders of the gospel. Not just citizens of the gospel, but a defender of the gospel. What's that mean? We need to understand what the gospel is and make sure we don't let it deter from the scriptural understanding of the gospel. But others, loving, knowing that I am set, Paul says, I am set for the defense of the gospel. I'm telling you, we're in a growing era in our culture where everyone who says Jesus, we're saying they're Christian. Jesus himself said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter. There's got to be a transformation. The word there, apologia, is a verbal defense of the gospel. So I'm willing to stand and defend. And he goes on in talking about what this is in verse number, or chapter 3 and verse 2, where he says, beware of dogs. Now, this is crazy here because the Jews understood dogs as anyone who was outside the Jewish faith. They were just dogs. And I just want you to know, I know in your mind you're thinking of some cute little puppy. Dogs were not all that domesticated when this is being written, okay? Dogs were dogs. They just ate the scraps outside the city. They weren't treated as humans. They were just dogs. So you got to get a hold of that. Some of y'all are like, oh, my doggy going to heaven. There's dogs in heaven. I'm not sure yours is making it, but there are animals in heaven. But you got to get the picture. And he's saying anyone, these dogs, these in this case, they were actually Judaizers that were coming in and teaching wrong things. these dogs, those not teaching the grace of God. And I want you to get this because it's important you get this so I can connect it to my next point. But you are only saved by grace. Please understand there is not a work you can do to get saved. You simply repent and receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you're born again. You're a child of God. You're part of His kingdom. He comes in, the Spirit of God transforms you, changes you, and you become different. He said these were evil workers or followed Jesus. They wanted them to follow Jesus in Judaism. In other words, they wanted them to get circumcised and be a little Jewish as well as a little Christian. Well, you can get saved, but if you're not getting in under Judaism, then you're not truly a believer. And Paul says, listen, the gospel is this. Now listen, the gospel is understanding your loss. You repent, you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. It's not just acknowledging that Jesus is Lord. There is a repentance that is part of the transformation of receiving Jesus as Lord of your life. See, this is what makes the gospel so hard. If you travel to India, is there's temple after temple after temple. And they don't mind saying, hey, let's put a Jesus temple here. And we'll worship Him too. See, Jesus doesn't want to be in line. He wants to be the true and living God that He is. And so you got to understand, He was willing to be a citizen of the gospel, but He wanted to defend what the gospel was. And church, if we don't wake up, we're condemning a lot of people who are trusting in works, trusting in religious actions to hell because we're wanting to say they're okay. When you read the book of Philippians, let me help us a little here. Your personal relationship with God was never meant to be personal, but relational with inside the church, the body. Now, you're the only one knows if you got saved. But it wasn't supposed to be this thing where we just hope you make it and hope you do what's right, but that we move in that way. To die well, you should live as a defender of the gospel. Those who, I can give some names of people I know who in the military got a general discharge, or a dishonorable discharge. You know, they just didn't cut it, right? And so if they got that and died, we're just like, well, they didn't, you know, their life matters, but it wasn't that they were faithful into it. But when they're willing to defend our freedom, they live well and die well. Listen, folks, we got to defend what the gospel is. The easy beliefism, raise a hand, say a quick prayer, you're in, is condemning people to a false hope that will end up in an eternal separation from God. I know we feel better when we think they're going to heaven, but that's not a good thing. We need to help them get to heaven through a relationship with Jesus. To live, Paul was abandoned all. He abandoned all for the gospel. Philippians 3:8 says, yea, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus Christ, my Lord. For whom, now listen, follow this, I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them dung that I may win Christ. Now Paul said he's willing to defend the gospel, right? Gospel's by grace. Everyone here believe that? But now he's saying he wants to win Christ. See, here's the thing that you got to get a hold of. Yes, when you get saved, you get it, but you're not where you should be, right? When you join the military, you do the pledge, you're in, but you're not where you're supposed to be. A whole bunch of people are going to join in, yelling at you, to get you to be what you're supposed to be. And they're going to make you into what you need to be. And then if you want to be better, they'll send you off to all these trainings and all these schools so that you could be a soldier that the military can use anywhere to do anything. And so, listen, this morning, God, if you're saved, that's awesome. But there's so much more you can have in Christ. If you'll grow in the grace, it's not connected to salvation. It's because of salvation. Get that. And stop calling people legalistic when they're not legalistic. Because if God said don't do it, then you shouldn't do it. That's part of sanctification and growing in God. Well, I'm saved anyway. Yeah, we're not arguing whether you're saved. You're just going to get a general discharge. Be sent home to glory early. Not fit for duty, right? Y'all follow me? And this was so lighthearted. And he found him not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ. The righteousness which is of God by faith. But look here, that I may know him. See, this is the coolest part about salvation. I'm so glad I got to grow in it. Because just being saved and not experiencing the joy of it is troubling. See, I you know, there's some people who have wealthy parents. I didn't. And it's always fascinating to me because they want to break away from their wealthy parents. And I'm like, you go ahead and I'll graft myself in. Because they have access to stuff and they're upset, you know. They drive a brand new car and they're like, I don't like my parents. Dude, you've got a brand new car. And a credit card to get gas. I'm pushing mine to the gas station because I didn't have enough to make it. It's the thing. And see, here's the thing. Jesus loves you, died on the cross for you, and if you repent, receive him, you get saved. But don't you want to live with the benefits of Jesus Christ? Don't you want the full benefits of a God who works and moves in your life? A God who can deliver? A God who could put coins in a fish's mouth and you can go fishing and find the money you need to pay your taxes? God who can work and move. See, the power of his, he wants to understand the depth of God. If by any means I might obtain unto the resurrection of the dead. See, to die well, you should live as a citizen of the gospel. You should stand as a defender of the gospel who is willing to sacrifice for the gospel. When you're enlisted in the military, you have to say this pledge here. You put your name in there. Do solemnly swear or affirm that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and that I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me, according to the regulations, the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So help me God. So when you come in, and you get assigned or get ready to start, they make you say this pledge because you got to be connected to what God or what the country wants you to do. I kind of rewrote it, and I think this will help us maybe understand. I, a born-again believer. Listen, this is not for someone not saved. This is for us who are saved. Do solemnly swear or affirm that I will support and defend the gospel of Jesus Christ against all enemies outside and inside the church. That I will bear fruit or true faith and allegiance to the same. That I will obey the orders of Jesus Christ and the teaching of the shepherds according to the truths of God's holy word. So help me God. And see, if we live a life that when we are for the gospel, so that when we die, the gospel is what comes out of everything we have done. So then we can say, to die is gain. Listen this morning, what are you living for? If you truly know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that is what we should live for. That's what we should stand firm together for. That's what we should be willing to defend. And not just the gospel, but growing in the grace and the knowledge of God, so that others can find Jesus. This Memorial Day, there'll be loved ones in cemeteries crying, missing, talking. Saw a picture of someone having a picnic because they missed their loved ones. But what if they died without the gospel? I hate hoping someone made it to heaven. Stand with me. Your heads bowed, eyes closed, attitude of prayer. How's your eulogy going to be? I've done funerals. I've saved people. Where I knew they went to heaven. I could sense the Spirit of God among loved ones because they knew that they went to heaven. I've done funerals where we weren't sure. Those are hard. Those are extremely hard. Who do you need to do a well checkup on? Father, right now I pray that you'll help us, first of all, know that we're saved. And if there's someone here this morning, Father, that never has repented and received you as Lord and Savior, Father, I pray today they'll do it. But Father, Lord, on this Memorial Day in 2019, Father, help us. Help us to realign ourselves to the gospel and to live a life like Paul that is willing to say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Consume us again with your love and your grace and with the importance of the message you entrusted us with, that maybe we can truly give freedom to a lost and dying world. We praise you for our redemption in Jesus' name. As we sing, would you respond to the Lord this morning?
If you'd like to find out more information or keep up to date on what's happening at Memorial Baptist Church, you can go to www.mbcnewhaven.com. You can follow our bulletin, stay up to date on sermons. You can also find us on Facebook or on our ChurchLink app. All the information is on our website. Please swing on by, check it out, and thank you for joining us.